In this video, we will talk about another type of the anemia, which is the macrocytic anemia. This is again a very common happening in the hospital and in the community. And this is always very important to know about the basics of the definition and causes and how to diagnose this case and how to manage it. So let's talk about the macrocytic anemia. So again, the macrocytic anemia is the combination of the two words. One is the macrocytic and then anemia. So there is anemia, and then it is macrocytic in nature. So what is anemia? We had already seen that whenever hemoglobin falls to less than 13.5 gram per deciliter in males, or it falls to less than 11.5 gram per deciliter in the females, this will be known as the anemia, or the reduction in the concentration of the hemoglobin in the body. Now, once we have defined anemia, we should talk about what is macrocytic. So this is something pertaining to the cells of the within the blood. Cytic means cells, macro mean larger. The normal mean corpuscular volume, of the red blood cell is 80 to 96 femtoliter. So whenever the size of the mean corpuscular volume, or the size of the RBC, is more than 96 femtoliter, we call it the macrocyte, larger size of the cell. So if this is the normal RBCs, then this will be the larger size RBCs, where the mean corpuscular volume will be larger than 96 femtoliter. This is what we call the macrocyte. So this is known as the macrocytic anemia. Now, the macrocytic anemia is broadly subcategorized into two classifications. It has got two categories. One is the megaloblastic anemia. Megaloblastic anemia. So that will be megaloblastic macrocytic anemia. And the other category or the classification will be normoblastic macrocytic anemia. So from the very outside, at the beginning, we should understand one very important point, that when we are naming these two categories of the anemia, which are obviously the types of the macrocytic anemia, we should know that megaloblast are the blast, they are related with the bone marrow studies. And macrocyte, they are related with the peripheral blood picture study. So these name comprise of the two realities that we are talking about the status of the red blood cell, not only in the peripheral blood picture, but also in the bone marrow. Because here, the size of the blast, which are the premature form of the RBCs, will be larger because of the defective or immature DNA synthesis. And here, the DNA synthesis, or the size of the DNA, or maturation status of the DNA, will be normal. Because we had seen in the past videos, when we started the anemia, that in the bone marrow, it all starts from a cell which we call the hematopoietic stem cell in the bone marrow. Hematopoietic stem cell, which gets converted into the multipotent progenitor with the help of the stem cell factor and interleukin 6 and interleukin 11. This multipotent progenitor then converts into the myeloid, common myeloid progenitor, with the help of the stem cell factor and interleukin 3. It gets converted into the erythroid megakaryocyte progenitor with the help of the interleukin 6 and interleukin 11, and this then makes the erythroblast in the bone marrow with the help of the erythropoietin. So this erythroblast then converts into the erythrocytes. But before that erythrocyte, it gets converted within the bone marrow to reticulocytes, which stays in the bone marrow for a couple of days, ultimately enters from the bone marrow into the blood as a reticulocyte, stays there for another 2 days and gets converted into the erythrocyte. Now, as the process within the bone marrow goes from here to here to here to ultimately coming down all the way down to the erythrocyte or the erythroblast, these cells, they lose their DNA. They lose their nucleus, but they retain the cytoplasm and hemoglobin. So, in abnormal situation, where we will talk about the macrocytic anemia, in abnormal situation, in the erythroblast, there is no loss of the DNA, or the nucleus becomes immature, it is stippled in appearance, it becomes sort of gobbled up. So this is what we call the macroblast or the megaloblast. So this is the basis of the name megaloblast, which comes from the bone marrow changes within the RBCs. So once we have seen these things, let's talk how the DNA is synthesized within our body and the bone marrow, and how these changes come and what causes these changes to come. So if we talk about the DNA synthesis, now it all starts with two very important components. One is the folic acid or folate, and one is the vitamin B12. So let's briefly talk about these two, then we'll move on to the formation of the DNA with the help of the folate and the vitamin B12. Now, vitamin B12 comes from the animal sources. So animals provide us with the vitamin B12. It doesn't exist in the plants. For example, we get it from meats, fish, eggs, and we also get it from the milk. So one thing is sure, that vegetarian will be deficient in the vitamin B12 in their bodies. So it is coming from the animal sources, and it is not destroyed by cooking. This is a very important fact. So whenever you cook the meat, there will be no destruction of the vitamin B12, and normally these sources provide us with almost 5 to 30 microgram per day is provided, is the vitamin B12, which is provided through the animal sources or the sources from where we get, because the vitamin B12 is not present in the vegetables. So out of this 5 to 30 microgram per day, only 2 to 3 microgram is reabsorbed, and in the liver only 2 milligram is stored. And if a patient becomes short of vitamin B12 in the diet, patient is not provided with the ample meat, fish, and milk and the eggs, then it will take patient almost 2 years to completely get rid of or be deficient of the vitamin B12. So vitamin B12 is from these sources, has got this much of the daily supply, only 2 to 3 microgram gets absorbed, and daily 1 to 2 microgram per day is lost from the body. So this is something basics about the vitamin B12, because it is going to help us in making the DNA. So now let's talk about the folate. From where comes the folate? Folate or the folic acid, it has got both the animal sources and the vegetables. From the animal sources, we have got the parts of the animal which supply us with the folic acid are the kidney and the liver. Kidney and liver, they supply us with the folic acid. Secondly, there are certain vegetables which supply us with the folic acids. What are those vegetables? These may be the spinach, it may be the broccoli. So these are the main source of the folic acid. Now the daily requirement of the folic acid is almost 100 microgram per day, and its storage is within the RBCs, and it is also present in the serum. Now the total storage in the body is 10 milligram, and if a patient is not giving those vegetables which contain the folic acid, and patient is not giving the artificial or fortified foods which are fortified with the folic acid, it will take the patient 4 months to be completely devoid of, our patient will have the complete deficiency of folic acid after only 4 months. But in all those patients who are admitted in the ICU and they are undergoing intensive care management, this may be like 1 to 2 months. So these are the basic facts about both the vitamin B12 and folic. And one added thing, that RBCs, if we check the folic acid from the RBCs, it is, the lifespan of the RBCs is 120 days. So it will represent that storage of the folic acid, which is around 150 microgram per liter. But in case of the serum, it will be almost 3 microgram per liter. So these are the body storage system of the folic acid. So once we have talked about the basics of the folic acid and vitamin B12, how these contribute in the DNA synthesis. Let's start from here. Dietary folate is provided to us. Dietary folate. Then it goes and gets converted into the methyl tetrahydrofolic acid in plasma. And this is mainly in the monoglutamate shape, monoglutamate form. Then this methyl tetrahydrofolate in plasma goes inside the cell as the form of the methyl tetrahydrofolic acid. And this is in the cells. Here happens a very important step, where we see that this methyl tetrahydrofolate is converted into the tetrahydrofolic acid with the help of another coenzyme. This is vitamin B12, which we've been talking about, also known as the cobalamin. And here we see the conversion of the, or methylation of the homocysteine into the methionine. So with the help of the vitamin B12, homocysteine gets converted into the methionine, and methyl tetrahydrofolic is sort of demethylated to the tetrahydrofolic acid. And this tetrahydrofolic acid then enters into another very important phase, which we call the DNA cycle. Now this tetrahydrofolic acid polyglutamate enters into the DNA cycle, and this then gets converted into the methylene tetrahydrofolic acid as the polyglutamate. Now this methylene tetrahydrofolic acid gets converted into the deoxyuridine monophosphate. So now here you will appreciate that both the folic acid coming from the dietary folate and vitamin B12, they are contributing in a process which we are calling the DNA synthesis, and which we are talking about here. Now this deoxyuridine monophosphate, it gets converted into the deoxythymidine monophosphate. Now this deoxythymidine monophosphate has got two fate. Either it goes to form, it gets converted into the deoxyribonucleic acid or the DNA, or it gets converted into the dihydrofolate polyglutamate. Polyglutamate. And with the help of the dihydrofolate reductase, it forms the tetrahydrofolic acid polyglutamate. So now, if we recap this whole process, what is this? What is written over the whiteboard? This is all about the DNA synthesis and the role of the dietary folate and vitamin B12 in the formation of the nucleus or nuclear material or chromatin. So dietary folate, it gets converted into the methyl tetrahydrofolic acid because something happens in the stomach where the polyglutamate form is broken down into the monoglutamate form. It enters into the plasma, and here we see that this methyl, it forms the methyl tetrahydrofolic acid in the cells, which gets converted into the tetrahydrofolic acid with the help of the vitamin B12, because homocysteine gets converted into the methionine. Now, this tetrahydrofolic acid gets converted into the tetrahydrofolic acid polyglutamate, because it was here the monoglutamate. Now, it enters into the DNA cycle. This whole cycle is known as the, DNA or deoxyribonucleic acid cycle. Now, this tetrahydrofolic acid polyglutamate, it forms the methylene tetrahydrofolic acid polyglutamate, which then gets converted into the deoxyuridine monophosphate, and it gets converted into the deoxythymidine monophosphate. All of this, this is the most important step. All these steps, out of all these steps, this is the most important step where we see the conversion of the deoxythymidine monophosphate into the deoxyuridine monophosphate into the deoxythymidine monophosphate, because here the contribution of the folic acid and the vitamin B12 ultimately comes into action. Now, this deoxythymidine monophosphate, either it will make the deoxyribonucleic acid or DNA, or it will make the dihydrofolate polyglutamate. This dihydrofolate polyglutamate, with the help of the dihydrofolate reductase, it will form the tetrahydrofolic acid polyglutamate, and this is how the cycle keeps on repeating one after the other. Now, we have seen that this whole cycle is the basis of the formation of the DNA and the basis of the synthesis of the are the basis of the development of the macrocytic anemia. Why? Because we had subdivided the macrocytic anemia into the megaloblastic and non-megaloblastic anemia, and we had seen the role of the vitamin B12 and the role of the folic acid in the causation of the macrocytic anemia. So what are those causes which lead to the deficiency of the vitamin B12? Because vitamin B12 deficiency and folic acid deficiency and certain drugs which cause the defects in the DNA synthesis, for example hydroxyurea, which contains the hydroxycarbamide and azathioprine, and certain enzyme like acid urea or orotic acid urea, they cause the defective synthesis of the DNA that becomes the reason of the megaloblastic macrocytic anemia, which is the most important cause. So what are the causes of the vitamin B12? As I already mentioned, vitamin B12 comes from the animal sources. So the most important cause will be the vegetarian diet, because it does not contain the vitamin B12. That is the reason that in the developed countries nowadays, they have fortified the cereals and the grains and the flour and the rice with folic acid and vitamin B12, just because of this reason, because vitamin B12 doesn't come from the vegetables. So one important reason is the vegetarian diet. Secondly, there are some causes which are related with the malabsorption of the vitamin B12. What is that malabsorption can be? It can be the congenital deficiency of intrinsic factor. So from where comes the intrinsic factor and what is its role? Now, if we make a stomach here, if say this is the stomach, it has got, this is fundus part of the stomach, this is body part of the stomach, and this is the pyloric entrum, and this part which is below the fundus is known as the cardia. So those cells, those parietal cells which are present in the fundal part of the stomach, they contain, they secrete intrinsic factor, which is a glycoprotein. It has got a molecular weight of 45,000 and it is secreted along with the hydrogen ion. What is the role of the intrinsic factor here? Intrinsic factor is secreted by parietal cell along with the hydrogen ion, and it will combine with the, vitamin B12 for its absorption. How it happens that this is the duodenum, I'm making a brief part of it, this is the jejunum, and say this is ileum. Now there are very specific receptors which we call the cubulin receptor. Now these cubulin receptors are involved in the reabsorption of the vitamin B12, but this reabsorption of the vitamin B12 is not possible without the help of the intrinsic factor being secreted from the parietal cells of the gastric fundal area. Now this intrinsic factor combines with vitamin B12 in the duodenum, and it goes all the way down here, ultimately reaches the third or the last part of the small intestine, which we will call the ileum. Here intrinsic factor combines with the vitamin B12 and they are attached to the very specific receptor which we call the cubulin, and here the vitamin B12 gets reabsorbed and intrinsic factor goes out of the body, it is excreted out of the body. But before the vitamin B12 combines with the intrinsic factor, it undergoes certain changes. Initially what happens that from the saliva there is coming a very specific protein which we call the vitamin B12 binding protein or R binder. Now it is coming from the saliva, it's staying in the gastric area to actually wait for the vitamin B12. But the problem is that vitamin B12 is attached with the proteins. So gastric juices or the gastric enzymes, they break down the vitamin B12 and get it freed from the other proteins. Once it is free, this R binder or vitamin B12, which is coming from the saliva, combines with the vitamin B12 and they move on to the duodenal part, where there is the secretions coming from the pancreatic glands. They break it free, they break the vitamin B12 free from the R binder, and they hand over the vitamin B12 to the intrinsic factor. Intrinsic factor combines with the vitamin B12, takes it all the way down to the ileum, where it gets reabsorbed into the cumulin. And from here, this vitamin B12 goes on to combine with another protein, which we call the transcobalamin 2. And this combination of vitamin B12 and transcobalamin 2 is known as the holotranscobalamin or active vitamin B12, because it will be present in the tissues and the plasma bound with the transcobalamin 2, and this combination of the vitamin B12 and transcobalamin 2 will be known as the holotranscobalamin, which is the active form of the vitamin B12. So whenever there is a congenital deficiency of the intrinsic factor, it will be a cause of the vitamin B12 deficiency because of malabsorption. So what is the third cause? It may be the gastrectomy. We had seen that vitamin B12 will be reabsorbed with the help of the intrinsic factor, which is coming from the fundal part of the stomach. So if there is no stomach, there will be no intrinsic factor. So this is again one reason of the vitamin B12 deficiency. What else can be the reason? Another reason can be the pernicious anemia. What is pernicious anemia? Pernicious anemia is an autoimmune disease. This is a form of the autoimmune gastritis, where the antibody formation happens against the parietal cell of the stomach. Now, these autoantibodies, these destroyed the parietal cells along with the destruction or absence of the intrinsic factor. Not only we have the antibodies or autoantibodies against the parietal cell, we also have the antibodies against the intrinsic factor. So all this is happening in which disease? Pernicious anemia. It's an autoimmune disease or autoimmune gastritis, and happens mostly in the female and also after 60 years of the age. And it destroys intrinsic factor, and it is also related with other autoimmune diseases. For example, pernicious anemia is related with the thyroid diseases. That is why thyroid cancer is very common in these patients, and these also have got thyroid and autoantibodies. Secondly, it happens in the Addison disease, and it also happens in the vitiligo. So the association of this autoimmune disease with other autoimmune diseases is very common. So this is what we call the pernicious anemia, and it's again a very important cause of the vitamin B12 deficiency. Some doctors, when they suspect the pernicious anemia, they give the steroids like the hydrocortisone, and it responds well to the hydrocortisone, and this becomes the basis of another notion that this is a truly an autoimmune disease which responds to the immunosuppressive drugs. Now, after the pernicious anemia, what are other causes? It may be the causes which are related with the ileum, because we had seen that ultimately vitamin B12 in combination with the intrinsic factor gets reabsorbed in the cubulin receptor, which are located in the ileum. So any ileal disease, or if they have got the resection of the ileum, will be a reason of the vitamin B12 deficiency. It can be the tropical sprue. It can be bacterial overgrowth, or it can be fish tapeworm. So these are all the causes of the macrocytic anemia, or causes of the vitamin B12 deficiency. Fish tapeworm, which we also call the diphyllobothrium latum, is the other name for the fish tapeworm. So other than these, one very important cause can be, because we had seen that transcobalamin 2 is related with the attachment of the vitamin B12, and this combination forms the holotranscobalamin. So if there is a congenital deficiency of the transcobalamin 2, it can be a reason of the vitamin B12 deficiency. And sometime nitric oxide, which inactivates the vitamin B12, can be a cause of the vitamin B12 deficiency. So let's recap the causes of the vitamin B12 deficiency, and these causes go something like this: that via vegetarian diet, congenital deficiency of the intrinsic factor, gastrectomy, pernicious anemia, ileal disease or the resected ileum, tropical sprue, bacterial overgrowth, fish tapeworm, also known as the diphyllobothrium latum, or the congenital deficiency of the transcobalamin 2 or nitric oxide. All these can be the causes of the vitamin B12 deficiency. Now, what are the causes of folate deficiency or the folic acid? Because we had seen that folic acid also contributes hugely for the formation of the macrocytic or megaloblastic anemia. So folic acid deficiency. Sometime these are directly related with the nutrition or absorption process, because the absorption process is the main reason why these patients are folic acid deficient, or it can be the excessive utilization in these patients. So what are the causes of the malabsorption? What are the causes of the excessive utilization? Sometimes these are related with the old age. Old people eat less, and we had seen that there are both the vegetable and animal sources of the folic acid. Old age can be a reason. Starvation can be a reason if someone is hell-bent on starving herself or himself. Poor social condition where people are not provided with ample food, both the animal and the vegetable sources. It can be the excess alcohol, because excessive alcohol intake not only causes the malabsorption, but also sort of makes it dysfunctional. Then it can be partial gastrectomy. Again, there is a problem with the reabsorption or absorption of the folic acid. It can be Crohn's disease. It can be celiac disease. And after that, it can also be the cancers. And there can be certain drugs which we call the antifolate drugs. These basically cause the they hamper the synthesis of the DNA. This is why we call them the antifolate drugs. For example, these will be the methotrexate. It can be trimethoprim. It can be the pyrimethamine, and it can also be the anticonvulsants. For example, phenytoin or primidone. So these are the antifolate drugs which are a reason of the folic acid deficiency. So other than the these causes are related with the absorption process impairment, and these are the antifolate drugs. And now sometimes there is excess utilization of the folic acid. For example, it can be pregnancy, and these are the physiological causes like the pregnancy, lactation, and prematurity. So these three are the causes which are happening normally in our bodies, that during the pregnancy, lactation, and prematurity of the baby, we need more and more folic acid. But there are certain pathological causes. For example, there are certain situations where a lot of RBCs are being produced, like in hemolysis. It can be certain malignancy where there is increased turnover of the red blood cells. There can be some infective processes going on in the body which require a lot of folic acid, for example, in patients of the intensive care unit. There can be certain metabolic processes. For example, it can be a good example is the homocysteine urea. And sometimes those patients who are on the hemodialysis are on the peritoneal dialysis, they are also deficient in folic acid, peritoneal dialysis, because they use it excessively. And then there can be certain small bowel diseases. There can be sometimes there are pathologies of the small gut where we have seen the deficiency of the folic acid, small gut problem. So we can chiefly divide the folic acid deficiency or the causes of the folic acid into the three main categories. There are some causes which are related with the absorption process, like the old age, starvation, poor social conditions, excessive alcohol intake, partial gastrectomy, Crohn's disease, celiac disease, and cancers. These are related with the malabsorption process of the folic acid deficiency. Then there are certain excessive utilization situations which can be physiological, like the pregnancy, lactation, and prematurity. And there can be some pathological excessive utilization causes, and these are the hemolysis, malignancy, infection, metabolic processes like the homocystinuria, and it can be the hemodialysis or the peritoneal dialysis situation, or small gut problems, but they are the minor, they have got the minor contribution in the causation of the folic acid deficiency. Then there are methotrexate. These are the antifolic drugs, are the drugs which hamper the synthesis of the DNA during the RBC synthesis process in the bone marrow. These are the methotrexate, trimethoprim, pyrimethamine, anticonvulsants like the phenytoin and the primidone. So these are all the major causes of the folic acid deficiency. Now, once these patients have developed macrocytic megaloblastic anemia, so what are the clinical features of these patients? The clinical feature of the presentation can be divided into two broad categories. Again, clinical features are divided into, one is the common presentation, common for both the folic acid deficiency and vitamin B12 deficiency. So the common presentations are related with the anemia issue itself. So this part of the disease, which we call the anemia, has given certain clinical features which are present both in the folic acid and vitamin B12 deficiency, and these are, like, these patients have pallor, jaundice because of the ineffective erythropoiesis, because of the deficiency of the both folic acid and the vitamin B12, and this ultimately gives a very particular lemon yellow color look to the patient. Lemon yellow look to the patient because of the pallor and the jaundice. Then it can be the glossitis or inflammation of the tongue and inflammation of the angle of the mouth, which we call the angular stomatitis. So these are the common clinical presentation for both the vitamin B12 and folic acid deficiency. Now, there are certain presentation which are directly related with vitamin B12, and which we call the, because it affects the peripheral nerves, it affects the spinal cord, it can cause certain presentations which are very specific to the vitamin B12 deficiency. Polyneuropathy presentation specific to vitamin B12 deficiency. So what are those clinical features? There may be symmetrical pins and needle sensation or paresthesias, symmetrical paresthesia of the fingers and the toes, they have got these pins and needle situation. There may be early loss of the vibration sense. There may be loss of proprioception. There may be progressive weakness of both limbs. There may be dementia. There may be paraplegia. These are all related with the vitamin B12 deficiency. There may be delusions. There may be hallucinations. And there may be a presentation of the optic atrophy or the VN issue. VN may be affected. So the clinical features of the vitamin B12 and the folic acid deficiency are subcategorized into the one which are common to both of these deficiencies, like paler jaundice, which gives a particular look to the patient, which is lemon yellow color look. Then it can be the glossitis or angular stomatitis, and there are certain neurological involvement of the vitamin B12 deficiency, which is the symmetrical paresthesia of the fingers and the toes, early loss of the vibration sense, loss of the proprioception, and progressive weakness. It may be the dementia, paraplegia, delusions, hallucinations, optic atrophy. So these are the clinical features of the patient. But one thing is very important. Sometimes these patient gets paralyzed because of the spinal cord issue, and if it happens once, it is almost or sort of irreversible condition. So after we have seen the definition, saw a little bit about the pathogenesis or pathophysiology, then the clinical features, let's talk about the lab test which we get in order to diagnose these patient. How we diagnose these patient? Diagnosis. First of all, in the diagnosis, which we get the peripheral blood picture. Let's give it a name, A. Peripheral blood picture. We get the peripheral blood picture where we see the macrocytes. We look at the mean corpuscular volume of the red blood cells, and we see that the size mean MCV is more than the 96 femtoliter. We have got larger cells, and not only this, but we also have 6 lobed neutrophils. So these are very specific hypersegmented neutrophils which we see in these patients, and if the problem is very severe, then there will be leukopenia and there will be the deficiency of the platelets. So peripheral blood picture is very important. Secondly, the bone marrow picture. So what happens in the bone marrow? We see that rather than the normal RBC, normal erythroblast, if a normal erythroblast is something like that, which has lost the nuclear or chromatin material and it goes the RBCs, but in these patients we see that there is much more chromatin material which is stippled and dysmorphic in shape. So these are very specific megaloblast, or these are the very specific primitive forms of the erythrocytes or the erythroblast, which we call the megaloblast. So here we are talking about the macrocytic megaloblastic anemia. But in case of the normoblastic anemia, which is also the macrocytic, there will be no such changes in the bone marrow, which we are going to talk about a little after. So bone marrow is very important test. Then what else we can get in these patients? We can also get LDH, lactate dehydrogenase, and serum bilirubin. Why? Because there is going on an ineffective erythropoiesis, which results in the destruction of the RBCs, and it ultimately leads to the higher concentration of the serum bilirubin in the body and also lactate dehydrogenase. We can also get serum vitamin B12 level in the body. Serum vitamin B12, and if it is indeed the case of the vitamin B12 deficiency macrocytic anemia, there will be a deficiency of the vitamin B12 in the body. Other than vitamin B12, we can also get holotranscobalamin 2 is an entity wherein we see the combination of the vitamin B12 along with the transcobalamin 2. This is the active form of the vitamin B12. And if we are not able to diagnose it with the help of the serum vitamin B12, then we can get these value of the holotranscobalamin 2. And we can also do the methyl malonoic acid, also known as MMA, methyl malonoic acid. MMA doesn't stand here for the mixed martial arts, but methyl malonoic acid. Again, if you are not able to identify the cause, with the help of the vitamin B12 and holotranscobalamin, only then you go for this test. And you can also get homocysteine level. We had seen that at one stage the homocysteine was converted into the methionine with the help of the vitamin B12, and if there is a lack of the vitamin B12, obviously there will be higher concentration of the homocysteine in the body, and this is how we can indirectly know something about the deficiency of the vitamin B12. Then we can also check folic acid, serum folic acid level, and RBC folic acid level. Folic acid level in the serum, if it is less than 3 microgram per liter, it will be an indication that there is a deficiency of the folic acid, and this is the recent deficiency. But if you check the RBC folic acid, and if it is less than 150 microgram per liter, then it shows the deficiency of the folic acid over the last almost 120 days, which is the lifespan of the folic acid, RBCs, not the folic acid. So the lifespan of the RBCs is 120 days. So other than these very specific tests, there are some doctors who go on to do the absorption studies, which are not possible because you need to have a radioactive vitamin B12, which is not so oftenly available. Some people do go for the endoscopy to get biopsy of the gastric area to know something about the intrinsic factor deficiency or atrophic gastritis, because it will be evident on the gastric biopsy. So these are some specific tests, but I hope with the help of these battery of the test, or these combination of the test, one is able to diagnose the macrocytic anemia, which is megaloblastic in nature. So how we manage these patients? The treatment of the macrocytic megaloblastic anemia will be very straightforward. How? Because we had a deficiency of some things, and we need to correct those things. So how the management of the folic acid and vitamin B12 deficiency is corrected? You provide the patient with the vitamin B12. Whenever we are talking about the vitamin B12 deficiency, always remember this isn't present in the vegetables. So if there are vegetarian, you need to give them the vitamin B12. You need to give them fortified foods which contain vitamin B12 other than the food itself. But it comes from the animal sources. So if there is a deficiency of vitamin B12, we give 1000 microgram intramuscular, and we give it over 2 to 3 weeks, over 2 to 3 weeks, to sort of bring the concentration of the vitamin B12 in the body around 5 to 6 milligram. And once we have achieved this much of the level, then this patient will be given 1000 microgram of the vitamin B12 intramuscularly every 3 months for the rest of his or her life. Every 3 months. So this is a very specific dose of the vitamin B12, which is given. How we can inject the patient intramuscularly with the 1000 microgram of the vitamin B12, and over the 2 to 3 weeks period, we bring it around like 5 to 6 milligram, and once we have achieved this level, then 1000 microgram can be given intramuscularly every 3 months for the rest of the patient's life. So food should be fortified. And if patient has developed certain other complication, they should be dealt with. And but providing the vitamin B12 or its fortification in the foods is very important. So what we do for the folic acid deficiency? If a patient has got a deficiency of the folic acid deficiency, we provide them with the tablets 5 milligram. Do not forget the pregnant female patient. Do not forget lactating mothers. Do not forget the mothers who had a child with a neural tube defect in the past and wants to conceive once more. You need to provide them with the folic acid, especially during the first 12 weeks or the 3 months of their pregnancy. In the first trimester, you need to give them 5 milligram of the tablet every day to provide them with ample folic acid. So in order, you need to avoid the neural tube defects because of the hampered DNA synthesis. But if a patient is to be put on the prophylactic dosage of the folic acid, you can give 400 microgram per day. in all those patients who plan to conceive in the future. So folic acid should be provided in these patients. Now there is another very important point. If you are to manage these patients, do not transfuse them, because majority of these patients have got the chronic anemia. There will be more risk rather than the benefit of transfusing these with the blood. Secondly, do not transfuse in the elderly patient, because they may go into the heart failures. Thirdly, if the patient has developed the vitamin B12 and you are going to give patient the folic acid and there starts erythropoiesis, and because patient is deficient in the vitamin B12, ultimately patient will very suddenly develop the neurological symptom which may hamper the patient's life permanently. So either always check the level of the both folic acid and vitamin B12. Otherwise, the best strategy is to give those medications which contain both the folic acid and the vitamin B12 all at the same time. This is very important, because sometimes we make a mistake, we load the patient with the folic acid, patient gets deficiency of the vitamin B12 which causes the neurological symptoms. So we need to have an eye and be vigilant about their levels over and over again. So lastly, what are those conditions where we see macrocytic anemia but it is normoblastic? Bone marrow hasn't got any megaloblast. So macrocytic anemia but normoblastic. Normoblastic. So blast cell are the premature RBCs in the bone marrow. They are normal. What are those conditions? The most important ones are, it may be the alcohol excess. If you drink more, you have this problem more and more. It can be the liver diseases. So pregnancy is a physiological cause of the normocytic macrocytic anemia. Alcohol excess causes is pathologically. Nowadays there is a rule that if you check the bone marrow picture and there are normoblasts but it's a macrocytic anemia, it's an indirect proof that patient has been chronically using a lot of alcohol. So liver disease can be a reason. Then reticulocytosis, all those conditions where is increased formation of the reticulocytes, for example hemolysis in the body and hemorrhages going on anywhere in the body, they will cause the reticulocytosis which ultimately leads to the normoblastic macrocytic anemia. So what else can be a reason? Hypothyroidism is another important cause of the normocytic megaloblastic anemia. There are certain drugs which are involved in the causation of the this problem. These are the hydroxycarbamide, which we so commonly know with the name of the hydroxyurea, and azathioprine. These are the important drugs which we use and these cause the problem. There are certain hematological problem which also end up with the causation of the normoblastic macrocytic anemia, and these are the pure red cell aplasia. It can be myelodysplasia. It can be multiple myeloma, and it can be aplastic anemia. So these are the causes of this problem. And lastly, there are cold agglutination also causes this normoblastic macrocytic anemia. But if we rewarm the RBCs, this problem goes away. Rewarming it back to the 37 degree centigrade. So that's all about the macrocytic anemia. Both of its causes, megaloblastic and the normoblastic causes. We had seen, if we had to recap in like 2 or 3 minutes, we had seen in this that there is a macrocytic anemia where we see the mean corpuscular volume, it is more than 96 femtoliter. It is subdivided into the megaloblastic and normoblastic anemia. Megaloblastic anemia has got two very important reasons: vitamin B12 deficiency and folic acid deficiency. Vitamin B12 deficiency is because it's coming all the way from the animal sources. So if you are vegetarian, you have got problem with its reabsorption, then you may have the vitamin B12 deficiency, which will ultimately lead to the defective DNA synthesis. And the folate is coming both from the animal and the vegetable sources. That can be a reason of the deficiency. And the pregnant female are more vulnerable and susceptible for its deficiency. So once the patient develops, there is a certain sign and symptoms which are related either with the both of these, like because of the anemia, or it can be the specifically related with the vitamin B12, which is paresthesia and all the neurological symptoms. So we need to timely identify the problem and promptly manage it to avoid the complication of these anemia. So that's all about the anemia. I hope it helps to have some idea of the problem. And if you like the video, please subscribe the channel and hit the bell icon.